Thank you for the introduction. Good afternoon. I'm going to keep it very brief. And although the paper is called American Implementation of an American of a Multiaxial Cyclic Plasticity Model, I'm just going to focus on the model and leave the numerical implementation and many other results for the time when we have more time. This model we are developing in Seville is just a generalization of the local strain method, which is normally applied in low cycle fatigue. Probably most of you know of this method. You know that this method is obtains the stress and strain for notch specimens using the cyclic curves and the stress cycles and also the Neuber hyperbole. And it also uses concepts like the memory rule or the methods to count cycles. The most usual one is rain flow. But the problem is that this method is only applicable to uniaxial loads. When we want to apply it to general cases with multiaxial loads, we have a problem. There are many models already that try to face this problem, but there is still not a consensus. The main problem is, for instance, how to count cycles in multiaxial loads. Well, this is what we are trying to do, to define a whole complete constitutive model to answer these questions. And how we do it? Well, the plasticity model, we know, has three main parts. The first part is a yield criterion. Our criterion is based on the idea of an elastic limit. It tries to generalize to the three decays what happens in a tensile test. In a tensile test, we have only one component of the stress, non-zero, and yielding occurs when this value reaches a certain value, which is called the elastic limit. What happens in multiaxial loads? How do we find the size of a whole tensor full of components in order to measure this when this tensor reaches a certain value? But we do it by means of a metric tensor. The metric tensor of the stress space, if we define the stresses as a vector, is given by a 9x9 matrix. And it allows us to define a parameter Q, which is just the distance from the stress point to the origin of this stress space. And this is the parameter that we are going to compare with a certain value. And when it reaches a certain value, yielding will occur. That means that the yielding surface is an hypersphere in this stress space. Okay. This metric tensor, I said, is a 9x9 matrix, which means 81 constant, but it is very much reduced for most materials, especially for isotropic materials. You can see that you have only one non-zero constant, which can be easily determined in a uniaxial cyclic test. Indeed, if you give a value of a half to this only one parameter, what you obtain is the von Mises criterion, which means that it seems that the model is not very crazy. The second part of the cycle constitutive model is the hardening rule, which normally is defined as a function. Well, you usually find in hardening rules is an equivalent parameter, stress, an equivalent stress defined as a function of the length of the plastic string path. It seems logic for our model to define this equivalent stress as this parameter Q, which is the distance to the stress origin, as this equivalent magnitude. But what we are going to do is not to define it as a function of lambda, the plastic strain path, the length. But instead of that, we are going to inverse this function and define the plastic strain increment as a function of this equivalent magnitude. So we have that relation between the increment of this parameter Q, which is the distance in the stress space, and the plastic strain increment. This function is called Hardening function, and it can be also easily obtained from simple uniaxial cyclic tensile test. And the last part of the constitutive model is the flow rule. We are saying that the plastic strain increment is given as a function of the this distance increment. So it seems natural to define the normality rule as the flow rule in this model, which says that only the stress increments that increase this distance group will produce yielding. This also provides a very interesting way to relate the plastic strain increment to the stress increment. If you see this way of defining the relation, you can see that there is a linear relation between the stress increment and the plastic strain increment, which is not very common. And with these three parts, the constitutive model is now completed. The equations, you see the three equations, the only parameters that you need to obtain experimentally are this Hardening function and the metric. The metric, depending on if the material is isotropic or not, will have more than one or two constants, but all of them can be easily obtained from experimental results. We have already presented how to do it in some of the congresses, so you can find it in the papers. But all this is only applicable to loading. What happens when a cyclic loads will have also unloads? What happened then? You cannot use this parameter Q anymore, because the distance of the stress space measured from the origin it doesn't make any sense anymore. But what we do is use the diameter of this hypersphere. I'm going to explain a little further this figure. This represents a loading path that starts at the origin. It goes all the way here and then comes to sigma m and then it comes here. The first part is just an unloading. It starts without load. The stress point moves apart from the origin, and the yield surface creates an increased size to contain all the time the stress point as normal. During this time, this part of the loading, you apply the first set of equations. But at this point, the load comes here. This is an unloading. And from here, it comes again all the way here. This is another unloading. Every time a reversal occurs, a new yield surface appears tangent to the old one, inner and tangent to the old one in this reversal point. At this point. So the new parameter in these equations will be the diameter of this inner hypersphere, as I compared it to 2D. And the equations remain basically the same, but instead of using this q, big Q, now we use the lowercase q, which is now diameter. And they are basically the same. Just to see if I can convince you to use this model, and just going to show you a couple of results we have obtained. We have implemented this model in a 2D MATLAB code and also in a multi-axial general UMAT subroutine for Abacus. We take advantage of this conference to offer you the both codes. So if you can, if you see the model interesting, you can let me know, and I'll gratefully give it to you so you can apply it. Because we are sure that with a good plasticity model you will improve your results, of course. And this here you can see how well it works with a uniaxial loading, cyclic loading, that the simulation almost lays on top of the experimental results. And if these are the case with a very, very general and complex loading history, you can see that the results are also very good. It might not seem though, but what I can tell you is not in the figure, but I can tell you that the results, the errors, are more or less the same as other models like Morov or Armstrong. So they are quite good. And this is it.